Greetings. Welcome to the freewheeling chat with Dr. Ravi Shankar Shetty. Dr. Shetty has over 21 years of experience in healthcare with special expertise in the diagnosis and management of a wide range of medical problems related to cardiac, thoracic, and vascular surgery. He is currently working with MS Ramaya Narayana Heart Center as senior consultant and chief cardiothoracic surgeon. Dr. Shetty has performed the highest number of cardiac transplants in the state of Karnataka. He has performed the first pediatric cardiac transplant in Karnataka. Dr. Ravi Shankar Shetty has performed over 5,000 cardiac surgeries so far. Dr. Shetty, welcome to the show.
Thank you for the kind introduction, Darshan.
Thank you. I have with me my co-host, Mr. Vital Kamath. Mr. Vital Kamath was the former BD, Europe and Emerging Markets for Mahindra Engineering. And he is also an entrepreneur and he runs his hotel business. Welcome, Vital.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dashrath. Pleasure to have you here, sir. Privilege talking to you.
Thank you. Thank you,
Vital. Dr. Shetty, you come from a family of lawyers and judges. Your younger brother is a lawyer and your father is a lokayukta. So how did you choose medicine as a profession?
Actually, after I took up, this is about 25 years ago, where unlike today's young generation, we were not so, focused or aligned to a particular course in the school. So we used to take science as a subject. So that from there you can diversify into become a lawyer, become an engineer, become a doctor. So I took up science. Then I took up, this National Law School entrance. Then I didn't get a seat there. Then I got a medical seat. So it was not planned as such. So it was like I was ready to go into any profession where, I would get a seat or I would fit in. So it was not that I was very, passionate about becoming a doctor from childhood. It just happened that, I was confused a little. I was like, I was thinking of all the fields. Then National Law School entrance, I didn't get a seat. Then medical, I got a seat. So I went to the medical. Because, even though my first family is not of doctors, my uncles, cousins, there were many doctors. So I had a little passion of becoming a surgeon. Probably, if I'd got a law, if I'd got law course, I would have been a little more confused. So since I didn't get the seat, I got medical seat, I joined medical.
No, because nowadays, medical is a first preference and then they choose law maybe. So you are the other way around. Dr. Shetty, I know that you are a good tennis player. So how did you balance your passion for sports along with your, the medical studies?
So this tennis actually we as a childhood sport, I started, we are in the club. My father enrolled when we were young itself. So every evening we used to go and play tennis and come back home. It was like a routine. So, till PUC, then as usual in first and second PUC, we stopped playing tennis. And slowly in medical course, it became less and less. But we used to play, those generations, we didn't have much of TV or laptop or internet. Was very rare in 1990s, early 90s. So we used to, our only entertainment used to be, playing in the evening. So that way we continued playing tennis. It had a huge, health benefit for me especially. Otherwise, I see the other way around, the newer generation, there are more options of, sitting home and playing in the laptops. So that option we didn't have at that time in the early 90s.
You chose medical as your field and you did your graduation in medicine. So how did you choose cardiothoracic surgery as your stream of specialization? Was there any specific reason for that?
So I always wanted to become a surgeon when I did medical. I was always interested in doing surgery. And once I joined general surgery, we have optional postings of, other different specialties like urology, cardiac surgery, neurosurgery. So I took, again by chance, one of my father's colleague, a judge, got operated in the Manipal hospital in Bangalore Manipal hospital. So I went to see him with my father as a courtesy call. Then we met Dr. Dev Shetty there, and he told, your cardiac postings, why don't you do with us? So then he started inspiring me, telling you do cardiac surgery. So then after my course, again, I was a little confused between urology and cardiac surgery. Then I thought to myself, you know, urology, there's a lot of competition, you know, and going to nursing homes with your kit and moving around in your vehicle. I was not up to it. And that 1 month of cardiac posting, I got interest in cardiac surgery. So, I wrote the Jayadeva entrance. I got through. So that's how, I joined cardiac surgery.
Now, if I may ask a question, now the consumers of this video mostly will be students. So keeping them in mind, I was just wondering, now times have certainly changed a lot from your days as a student. Okay, you are a student from the last millennium. Okay, from the days of, you know, a blackboard and a chalk. Then a time has come wherein, you know, you have audio visual cues and a lot of, you know, practicals, and that has seen a whole lot of change. So a drastic change has come. But now in the current scenario, we are going through a pandemic, you know, and learning and development, at least I feel, is something that needs to be looked at. So during this time of online learning, do you have any tips to give to our youngsters, you know, to cope with the pressure of the pandemic, not let the pandemic fatigue set in, but still, you know, take academics seriously?
The thing is, with medical students now, because of the pandemic, for example, the first year students are missing out the practicals completely, what we call anatomy dissection, because I've been part of this, I'm a syndicate member in the Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences. They have missed totally, the first year batch has missed the anatomy dissection. So, you know, they are imagining and, you know, on online learning. So it's become very difficult for them to, you know, gain the knowledge, you know, on the imagination. We used to do dissection on the human body, and then the grasping is to be better and the understanding is to be better. It's a huge disadvantage, but then nothing can be done about it. I think it's a huge, more than, you know, there are two type of problems in this. There's physical as well as mental issues. I think this mental, there's a lot of mental issues we are seeing, and, you know, even not only the students, the staff, you know, in their family, especially ladies who are working at home, they're having a lot of issues. They're overburdened with homework and who are working from home. So it's a testing time, but I think the students have to stay, you know, strong, and they have to continue their physical activities. Actually, you are getting more time to study, but then maybe the orientation has to be, you know, they have to be more motivated, and among themselves, they have to be discuss, and they have to come through the classes. Otherwise, I'm sure it's a very testing time. And other students also, second and third year, they're not been able to attend the clinicals. So again, it's a huge disadvantage this couple of years. So, but I'm sure we'll overcome it. There's no other option but to stay strong, and I think even stay physically fit and do a lot of exercise and meditation, that should help.
Thank you for your insight, because if I may ask another question, now that you have accumulated 2 decades worth of accomplishments, and looking at your biodata, there are a lot of breakthroughs, there are a lot of first time events in the medical realm that you were a part of. What would you say is the most satisfying feather in your cap? What would you say is the one accomplishment that gave you the most, Pleasure. On the same note, if I may ask an offset of the same question, what do you think was the most challenging, accomplishment that made you push yourself to the limits?
See, I've climbed the ladder up very slowly. It's not that, after doing my MCH in Jayadeva, I worked in Narendra for 5 years. I didn't try to become independent too early. So I worked under different surgeons for every 6 months or so. I kept changing the senior consultants just to grasp their techniques and see what they're doing differently, the goods and the bads of each person. So I didn't jump to become a consultant or be independent too early. So it was 5 years in Narendra after my MCH. I didn't have a break in my studies. That is, up MBBS, MS, MCH, I hardly had 1 or 2 months break. So then, the long time I worked in even pediatric. So every department of cardiac surgery or cardiac surgery I went through. Then I got an offer in Satya Sai. So I went as a senior, as a consultant there. I worked there for 2 years. I think that was the period where I got a lot of confidence because in that, the whole team from the Satya Sai Hospital had left. So the director invited me and I went. That was the time I think I got a lot of confidence because there's no one else, to back me there as the senior most person there. So anything, complications, anything I had to manage. I think that was one of the most satisfying and challenging time. And what I, put me to a fame is the pediatric surgery, which I did a single coronary from the pulmonary artery, which is a very rare condition, which by chance had to, the patient had complications at the railway station and they brought it here. And it was not diagnosed, and we diagnosed in the operation theater. And we operated, and we later found out it was the first case to be successfully operated in Asia, and only fifth successful to be operated in the whole world. And when we did that, we didn't know. After searching the literature, we realized that, and we got a huge coverage from CNN, and it was published in the journal. I think that was one of the good, which gave us confidence, and it put us into the open, and people realized that Rama, some good work is going on. And the second thing is we started doing heart transplants and temporary artificial hearts with very good results in Ramaya Narendra here at Bangalore. And that gave a lot of confidence to the patients. We were confident that, and we were doing good in all the fields, even adult surgery. But this, the patient's outlook is, when they can do heart transplants, they must be doing other surgeries also well. So that was the outlook of the patient. So that's how our unit, I think it gave a big boost to our unit, that starting the cardiac transplant program.
Wow, that was so inspiring to listen to. It's a wonderful thing that I just got to know. So after the surgery, you came to know about the gravity of what you have performed.
Yeah, we actually, this is usually what we say is a blood supply to the heart arises from the aorta artery called aorta.
Right, right.
So the aorta didn't have any coronary arteries. It was arising from the pulmonary artery.
Right.
So to stop the heart, we give a solution. When we gave, it was not going in. So then we realized it is from the pulmonary artery. Then we opened it and we stopped that and we did the surgery. So then after searching the literature, we realized it's such a rare condition.
But you must have had a lot of on the spot, you need to take, you took a lot of critical decisions with on the spot thinking, on the feet thinking, and that simply makes me so happy to hear this story from your end.
When I left Satya Sai Baba Hospital, the day I was leaving, one of those devotees most of them who are working are, you know, devotees. He told, you know, Swami will send you cases.
Okay.
So what did it happened to be that this case went to Satya Sai Baba Hospital, and then they told, because hole in the heart, you can wait, and they sent back, and then it came to our hospital.
Right.
It is a little difficult to diagnose on echo.
Right.
This condition. So echocardiogram. So then they are told. So then after I finished this surgery, and it, you know, it gave a, it became like a media hype. Then I remembered what those guys were telling. When they told, I thought, you know, casual, you know. I told, okay.
And I asked how old you were when all this happened?
I think I was 36 then.
How long into your career as a surgeon were you when this?
7 years. 7 years after MCH, after cardiac surgery training.
Okay. Yeah. Very, very, very fascinating.
So, a young doctor performing breakthrough surgery and knowing that it's a breakthrough surgery after going through the literature.
Exactly. That's the most fascinating part about this story. But, you know, this incident could have gone either ways. Now, you came out of it on the positive side. And, you know, there were laurels and accomplishments after this incident. But God forbid it had gone on the other side, you know. And a lot many surgeons go through that. Do you have any tips for our youngsters or the next generation of, you know, surgeons that will follow your footsteps? What keeps you motivated? What keeps you grounded? What keeps you from, you know, not succumbing to failures, but, you know, in this eternal grasp of, you know, wanting to succeed and wanting to better other people's lives? What would you say motivates you?
See, cardiac surgery is a great leveler, unlike other, you know, fields. If you're not grounded, the success in the next case, the commonest, you know, the simplest case, if you take it for granted, and if you don't do a proper work, you can land in a lot of complications. So it's a field where you spend a lot of time, you know, post-operative. If you've not done your work in the operation theater, is not, you know, done well, the patient will show, most of the time they start showing immediate results, complications in the post-operative period. So it's a great level, and you know, you can't have the ego. So it's such a field where, you know, you can't take it for granted, and in the next simple case only you can land in huge trouble. So if you take any steps for granted, there's a, you know, protocol which we follow. If you take any small step for granted or you don't follow it, you can land in trouble. In COVID-19 pandemic, only the younger doctors have done most of the work. The senior consultants and the senior most people who are little old have not entered the COVID ward. It's the younger interns, postgraduates who have done majority of the work. And I'm sure it has been very stressful because, you know, they do 10 days of duty. They have to isolate them from their family. And during doing duty also, you have a chance of getting COVID. And initial days, there was no vaccine also. So, and while donning and duffing, you know, they couldn't have food with each other also in the COVID wards, because, you know, when you remove your mask, some of the doctors who got infected was during the lunch session or something like that. So it was that was a very stressful period. Now, at least, you know, we know what the virus is and a little more confidence is there, and vaccine has helped. At least we are more safe. We might, even if we get COVID, it won't be life-threatening, most probably. So I think COVID-19 pandemic has put a lot of stress on the doctors and on the hospitals. I think this will be a good learning for the youngsters if they take it very positively.
Doctor, since you have brought out the topic of corona now, during corona, that's the current pandemic, we saw that, you know, there was acute shortage of beds and, you know, oxygen supply. Do you think that we can handle it in a better manner?
I'm sure we can handle it in a better manner because we are more prepared now. It was a sudden, you know, increase in the cases, which the hospitals or the government was not prepared for, and even the people were not prepared for, and it's partly we all have to be blamed for everything, because you know no one took the proper precautions of you know wearing the mask or, and the social distancing. I think this time I see more people even on the road. If there is crowd, most of them are wearing the mask, and hopefully I hope that people will take vaccine. So at least now some population is vaccinated. I don't think so there'll be the bed shortage will happen this time. That's the thing. And second thing, last second wave, most of the youngsters died because below 45 they were not vaccinated.
There is a discussion going on that there will be an acute shortage of doctors and nurses in the days to come. Do you think there should be a more liberalized policy for starting medical colleges or new medical colleges? Or do you think there should be also a network of medical colleges so that we can handle the pandemic better?
See, today in Karnataka, if you take whole of India, there may be some shortage of doctors. The issue is you can't just give permissions to medical colleges just because there's shortage. We have to think about the quality education. There should be, you know, there should be the facility or training to train the doctors, and then not just open medical college. So for example, if you take in Karnataka, we have 60 medical colleges. We have just 30 districts. How many more do you want to treat Karnataka doctors? So if you take, I had prepared a health project. Actually, I gave to governments. It's, I don't know where it is, the thing. I mean, which been there thrown it. So if you have, see, about 50, including government and private, which country, even USA in any state won't have, you know, 50, 60 medical colleges with such a huge staff. Such a huge staff. So if you take each district, if you give two medical colleges, if you take, one MP constituency has 8 MLA constituents, 4 MLA constituency, 1 medical college, if they can't manage. And it's all almost in all the districts, it's there except a couple of districts like Chikmagalur. We have 5 medical colleges in Mangalore. If one takes over Chikmagalur, a small district, it can be covered. It's not a problem. It's, I think the focus is not there and the will is not there. There's no shortage of doctors in Karnataka. Maybe all over India, there is shortage of doctors. The thing is, doctors are not going to nook and corner of not South Kendra, other North Karnataka district villages. Because, you know, if I have done cardiac surgery, I'm not going to go to some village where my children won't have school. First, the infrastructure has to be there. It's not the only the shortage of doctors. And even if, for example, it doesn't depend on you, it depends on your family, if your wife is working. So it's, if she's in the IT, so she might want, Bangalore. So it has to be, the development has to be spread out. So if just whoever passes is not going to go to any village and practice unless he's from that village. Because if you take Manipal, it's not a big city, but it is like, it's as good as Bangalore. You get everything there. Maybe for a student is much better than Bangalore. It's a student's hub. So that infrastructure has to be there. What will a family look for? They look for the children's education, hospital, whatever. So that's important.
Couldn't agree more. Thank you so much for that wonderful insight. Because on a lighter note, I don't know what the best export of India is, but it's certainly doctors. So you are absolutely right in saying that we need to tighten our regulations as well.
So maybe when you joined and the day today, things have changed a lot. Today I hear that, doctors have to be more of engineers also. So how technology has impacted your field?
The doctors have not become engineers as such, but, the technology like, minimal invasive surgeries, robotic surgeries, these fields have evolved, looking, more exciting and technology is improving. And more non-invasive work is happening, unlike earlier. So things are, looking good for the patients. And it has become now, more a customer-driven society. So, you know, hospitals, especially corporate and paying hospitals, have to be there up in the league. So it's a consumer driven market, I feel, today. So even the doctors have to be up there, they have to upgrade their knowledge and technology. And, you know, now all this CT scan, MRI, which was being, you know, earlier it was a luxury. It is a basic necessity and it's available, you know, not only in our hospitals, even there are 3-4 diagnostics on the road. So, and I think it's a total consumer-driven market like any other field now. So it's very good for the patients. I think it's a good thing, technology as a technology-driven market. I think because of the pandemic, the latest is, you know, patients are sitting home and consulting the doctors. They don't have to travel or meet the doctor. Telemedicine has taken up in a big way. We are doing online consultation and the patients are happy that this telemedicine has grown. And this telemedicine can be, you know, used very well to cater this rural population. You can have a virtual OPD of assistant or junior lecturers sitting in a virtual OPD in each department. I'm just giving an example. A general surgery, general medicine, he can conduct a virtual OPD through the ASHA workers for each village on different days. You know, in Karnataka, for every 1,000 population, there's an ASHA worker. So she has the data of the 1,000 people. They're not patients. I'm talking about 1,000 people in that village. So that data can be grabbed by Manipal. Or I'm just giving example of Manipal because you're from Manipal. So they can, you know, the preventive medicine. So what's happening on the BPL, we are operating, charging the patient, hospital is making money, government is spending money. Same thing can be treated, I mean, they use for treating the patients for diabetic and hypertension, preventing them from becoming kidney patients or heart, later landing up in heart issues. So this way, the money is saved. So even it helps the patients.
And you have very nicely and, so easily you have put across a point. Which the beauty of your solution is the simplicity and the onus is on us to Dashrath. The onus is definitely on us to make sure the right people listen to such valuable advice. Huh?
Thank you, doctor. Before asking for your final message for the youngsters, I would like to summarize what I have learned from you today, because I think this was one of the interviews where we learned a lot. Okay. So what I came to know is 10th standard is too early to choose a career. From him, what I understood that 12th, even after 12th, you need some time to decide which should be your career, which he had a choice between law and medicine. Then, the studies and your passion for games or sports can go hand in hand without affecting each other. The next part, what I learned from him today, is that, as he said, Karnataka produces highest number of doctors, and we have for every district, I think we have around 4 medical colleges. And if we network these medical colleges in a better manner, I think we can handle all the, ailing people and give them the necessary support. Then what has the pandemic done? The positive side of the pandemic is the how the telemedicine has evolved and has been adapted. I think this is here to stay. I think post-pandemic, I don't know. We were talking about post-pandemic for last 2 years now, Vital. I don't know when that will be a reality. But anyway, telemedicine is here to... Then what we also have learned is that, once he finished his studies, he took 5 years to become an expert. In the sense, he worked under various doctors and became an expert, and then he chose that, okay, today I'll go independently and take up the senior role. I think this has to be taken up seriously by all the young doctors, and not only doctors, all the professionals. You cannot be an expert in a day. So it should be a gradual increment. So I think these are the learnings what we got through our discussion today.
Yeah, After 7 years, I mean 5 plus 2 years in Satya Sai, I was called back to head the Ramaya unit.
Okay.
You got it. It's not that they told you, why don't you come and head the Ramaya unit? So if you are sincere and you try to gain more knowledge and skills, you will be called back. I think youngsters have to be a little patient. And actually, I took a huge dip in the salary also from Naran Vidhala to Satya Sai. But then it was, such a good experience. And I think that was the, highlight of my career. I'm still a visitor.
Institute of Excellence, you compromised on your earning.
Yeah.
And that's such a beautiful thing to hear. But the challenge with today's generation might also be that you have paid for your seat so much that you have to pay the bank also for the seat. So, you might have the pressure of not doing some of the things that you have done. So, as a society and as the way we function right now, the government also needs to take a deep dive and see, okay, we need to reduce the burden on students. Otherwise, we will not have more Dr. Ravi Shetty's like what you have done. So, yeah. I think the government also should seriously listen to this conversation.
Doctor, your final comments before we end our discussion today. A message for youngsters. Anyway, of course, your entire talk has been a message. I don't know which is the one part which is not a message, but maybe as a summary, you can just give a message for youngsters.
I don't know what, even I as a youngster, I was not very, focused in the sense I was not oriented to join medical. I think today's youngsters know better. They are more smart. I think, even the parents have one or two children. They are more, they're putting all effort on that child. I think I see today's, youngsters, they have a lot more knowledge than what we had. Probably because of their working on the, internet. And they're much smarter than what we were. I think it's not only medical, engineering or other fields. Now, yesterday I was talking to my friend. He was saying his son is going to do some animation in UK. Animation and some directing or something, which we didn't know. We knew medical engineering when we joined medical engineering and law, all such professions. Students should look out for more and more profession and which they're passionate about, they should do. And especially medical, they should do only if they're very passionate and they can sustain. Now, I think the younger generation, they know which college they want to get into also. I see my cousin's children, they are so focused and they tell us, I want to get into this college, that college, So I think they are very smart and they know what they want. And the only thing is they should have the commitment and they should follow through. That's what I feel.
I can only summarize this way, Dasrat, that Dr. Shetty's humility is even grander than his sense of than his accomplishments. Okay, and he's a very grounded person. And all the students who are listening to this should take a cue from that also.
Doctor, it was a pleasure talking to you. And we learned a lot today, like as I summarized earlier. Thank you so much. Vital, you always bring in that intellectual component for our discussion.
Thank you for including me. Always a pleasure.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vital. It was a pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Bye.